Good afternoon. This is Shuchi Nagpal, CEO, Asian School of Cyber Laws. As you will all very well know, we are celebrating the Indian Information Technology Act turning 21 this year. And as part of this celebration, we are having these the series of interviews with experts from the field. Joining me today is Dr. Patathil Dhanya Menon. First and foremost, Dhanya, welcome. Dhanya has been a student
at
the Asian School of Cyber Laws. I love the fact that she has grown so well in the field of cybercrime investigation. In 2018, Dhanya was awarded the President's Award for being the first woman cybercrime investigator in India, which I don't know, made us all feel so proud at Asian School. So let's dive right into it with Dhanya today. Dhanya, tell me something. How has your journey been in the last so many years?
Thank you very much for the invitation. Yes, it feels, I feel very honored being called for to talk about in the, especially from the associate, from the organization where I learned. And initial days, as all of you all know from the Asian School also, none of us knew what this particular topic was all about. I still remember the day where I was talking to Mr. Gokul Narayanan in Cochin, and I was asking him, what are the possibilities of studying this thing? Because I got into this, but then I didn't know what are the possibilities of learning or studying in this particular area. And I think we were asked to take class for the police of Kerala. And I was quite nervous. And that's when he told me that, 60 or 250, how many of our police officers are there sitting in front of you, Dhanya? You may not know all of them, but just remember that after the class, all these people will know one person in this field, and that will be you.
Wonderful.
So it's an opportunity. So it was like, all these little things, I don't know whether he meant it or whether he was, or I don't know what it was. I had no clue at that point of time, like where all this is going to head. And where we are going to reach out to. But then I think these were the cues that came across during this particular journey, where I felt every day was an opportunity given to me. So initially I got into this without knowing anything, but then every day unfolded before me with an opportunity and with a realization of what this field and I could do together for the society. So every day it was unfolding before me, and every day was actually a surprise. I would wake up with a new reason, with a new cause, something where I felt, nobody had an answer, but probably even if I didn't have an answer, there was something where I could at least try to make some little sense to whatever the issues that were happening across. So that way, if you look at it, last so many years in this particular field, as a human being also, there's been a lot of changes in me. A lot of things from a normal, I would call a very below average girl who just wanted to work and dance probably. I'm being honest, because all I wanted to do in life was dance. But then, from there, life gave me a set of personal problems, which I didn't know how to sort or go about with. And I thought those were the biggest problems in life. But then when every issue in this particular field came in front of me, where the other people were facing a lot of problems, it just made me realize that, what I was going through in my personal life is not even the cherry on the butter icing cake, other than so many issues. And they were far more into problems than I was into. It helped me evolve as a person too.
That's wonderful. So tell me, over so many years, I'm sure you've seen so many different kinds of cases. What would you say is the one biggest change that you have seen in this field?
There's a lot of awareness that has come about from what we were before. And now there's a lot of awareness that has come about. People actually know what is a cybercrime. Earlier, it was a very, very different kind of a very confused state of affairs where, people didn't know what they were facing, whether what kind of a crime, and even if they felt that they have been violated and they go to the police station, they also didn't know where to put this, how to place this. Now, I'm not saying, you know, every case even today has a proper solution and a proper methodology that the police stations are going through today. Not even today, you can find things like that happening in every station in India. But it has changed a lot from where people used to frown and look at you, you know, as if it's some kind of a big sin that you have been on the cyberspace to get into or get to be violated or get into a vulnerable space. From there, this is now a lifestyle which everybody cannot overlook. Not any person can overlook that this is one kind of a lifestyle that we have. And it is very normal that you get into issues or probably accidents. All you can do is probably be careful, but not completely avoid situations.
Wonderful. I think that's a superb explanation of how things have changed. And you're right. I mean, just as we deem that every day when we move out onto the roads, there are accidents, in a similar manner, well, this is another highway. And yeah, sometimes things just do go wrong. And it's nice to know that there is not shame associated with it today, which is really good. Yes. Tell me, as far as the technology, as far as the field of investigation is concerned, what else do you think has changed?
Well, technology has changed. I mean, it has upgraded every 6 months we see a change. We see a little bit of new languages, new kind of applications coming in. Devices have changed.
Okay.
Like when I started off with Asian school, studying at Asian school, I think the branches of cyber crime investigation or cyber investigations of forensics were about computer forensics were different, mobile forensics were different, internet forensics were different, and they were all different kind of terminologies, different kind of fortes that all of us needed to know before we got into this thing. Now there is no separation like that. Just you know, everything bunched up together, like how we have the mixed vegetable kurma. Everything is bunched up onto this little device that we have on our. I'm holding on in our palms. It's just that everything so integrated and come together. So that kind of a technical advancement or progress has happened.
Okay.
And law has also seen a reasonable level of updation. Like you say, I mean, if you look at it, till about every 2 years, we have seen an updation in the law till 2012. But then I think it's a long way because, I was taught that law always tags behind technology. So I think we are still waiting for the legal part to come up and match the pace of technology. And I think that's how everything works.
As an investigator, Dhanya, how often and how much do you need to work towards trying to keep yourself updated? Because things are changing really fast.
There are two things about it. Like, you know, when you're working on the corporate segment or when you're working on the social segment, I mean, whatever segment you're working on, I mean, basically the corporate segment, the updation on the technical platform has to be really, really update. You can't be like, you know, you have to be update for day after tomorrow if you need to take up work today.
Okay.
But whereas when you're looking at the social segment, when you're looking at the courts and the police stations, I would say we still have that freedom to work at least one week behind. You know, we can be 1 week laid back. And courts, of course, are definitely with the legal system in India here right now. I think the case that has been filed in 2009 saw a verdict only last month. One of my cases that we have filed in 2009 saw the verdict only now, last month. So we still have a lot of time to update and upgrade ourselves when, as far as the legal system is concerned. Mm-hmm. But yes, again, the filing part, the evidence quarantining part and all that, we have to be updated.
Okay.
Most of the time, the social aspect and all, the platforms keep changing, but methodology of crime hasn't changed much on the social line.
What do you
at least not to my
would you like to clarify that statement? I mean, in the sense, are you seeing that a certain pattern is maintained in terms of the kind of methodology and all of that? Yeah,
Exactly. Now, see, basically, most of the social cases that I have been dealing with relate to women and children. If you look at it, the methodology is the same. People used to stalk children or women on Orkut. Now they're doing it on Facebook, Snapchat, or Telegram. That's all. I mean, the platforms have changed, but the methodology, the kind of, if you look at it, the initial phishing mails that they send, or probably the friends requests that they send, or probably the encounters, the platforms for such encounters have changed.
Yeah.
But I would say the way they come, try to befriend somebody, it's all the same. I mean, it's all the attack on the brain, that's all.
Absolutely. So I guess somewhere that's where we need to become stronger. So if the human brain realizes that it is, you know, someone's trying to fool you, you're that much more aware and alert about these kind of things. Yeah, I absolutely.
Exactly.
Tell me something else, Tanya. So you mentioned some case of yours, which was filed in 2009, coming to fruition now. So are you called upon as an expert also for providing, like as a witness kind of a thing that, okay, I'm the investigator, so this is how I've gone about investigating this case. And is that also part of your work?
Yes, I do. I get called in as a special witness. I also undertake commissions, special commissions on the data digital platform.
Oh, okay.
So that way, yes.
Oh, all right.
This was one case where I was the commission, appointed the commission for a digital case. And but the verdict came only last month. So I did. We finished the work in 2009, redid the whole thing in 2012. But then verdict is just now.
Okay. No, so obviously it is still a slow process. And from what I understand, yes, number of convictions in this field are still quite low. Tell me, how well equipped do you think our law enforcement and judiciary are to handle cyber investigations as well as digital evidence?
If you ask me to answer this in one word, it would be they're laid back. Very much far behind.
Oh, really?
They really need to be updated. Yes. Now, the judiciary definitely needs a lot of upgradation and all that. But law enforcement as a police side, most of the states have equipped themselves with their high-tech cell and cyber cell and their forensic tools being in place and all that. But still, I would say there is a challenge that, you know, they feel that they need a requirement or they need to procure a particular tool today. Once the order is placed, the red tapism is over and the order comes into place, the version 1 would have been upgraded technically to version 12.
Oh my. Oh, that's...
There is a lot of challenge that way, yes. There are a lot of challenges as far as the legal system is concerned. But the police department is a little far more advanced than the judiciary. Judiciary needs a lot of...
Okay.
A lot of, updations or probably even... there is a lot of challenge in the admissibility of certain petitions in the court also, which we see, which I face definitely. Oh. This is my personal experience. I may be wrong when it comes to somebody else, but for me, I have gone through these challenges. I still go through these challenges.
I'm sure, because you're absolutely right. Certain things remind us that, you know, while, like you mentioned, the phishing emails, very honestly, it's very fine to say, oh, technology has changed. There are so many now new opportunities for attacking people and all of that. When you really boil it down, it still comes down to certain basics not being in place. So tell me something, which is the corporate-wise, as far as companies are concerned, which is the most common crime that you're seeing right now?
Corporate-wise, it is basically data theft itself.
Okay.
Which happens, like, you know, if you're looking at the IT sector alone, then it is basically a theft of completely made software program which is being stolen, things like that. But if you look at the other organizations like financial organizations or even hospitality industry or insurance sector, mm-hmm. there's a lot of data pilferage that is happening, which probably is not even noticed till it is being misused.
Wow.
During COVID time itself, you know, we have had issues from insurance companies where they say their data is lost from even TPAs, third party
agreements.
Yeah, we have had issues.
Oh, okay. And what about how many cases or how often do you see issues like ransomware and all creeping up?
Oh yeah, that's like, you know, but ransomware in the sense, you know, maybe we see about 3 to 4 issues of ransomware every month here in the office where people do come and approach us. But, you know, because people don't have that kind of a data hygiene practice where they have a data contained only on a particular device, because of which if there's a ransomware attack, there is a complete data loss, that still is not in place, luckily.
Okay.
So, you know, they don't have to actually go. They just need to discard that particular system, discard the network, redo the, buy one or two equipments and redo the network. And they are good to start again, probably 1 month back onwards, or probably 2 weeks back. That's it. So we've had a lot of professionals from the chartered accountants, accountants and company secretaries also have being attacked with ransomware here.
Okay.
A lot of them, including public sector organizations, but more so with the professionals.
Oh, really? Okay. And this is despite...
Doctors.
Acha. Okay. I can understand. And in fact, they have a lot of sensitive private data also. And for them to lose data or lose access to that data must be extremely worrisome. I mean,
no, that's what I want. I just want to make it very clear that, you know, they have not lost data. They've just lost access or the utility of that particular device.
Okay.
Once they have another device, they'll have data somewhere else in some other system, some pen drive somewhere else, some other hard disk, some other things in their office. Which is again vulnerable. If you ask me, you know, anybody in that office can just decide that I want to take this data and walk away, and probably the owner of the office will not even realize that he has lost the data.
But as far as ransomware,
that kind of
that decentralization
turned out to be an advantage. Exactly.
I can understand. Acha, in the coming years, tell me, what do you see is going to be the biggest challenge according to you, which is going to face this field?
In the coming years, I have, like, you know, I've not been able to think far beyond in all, Suchi, actually, honestly speaking, because every day it's been, maybe the biggest challenge over the years would be, you know, the adaptability of law and technology, you know, combining this legal system and the technology, because, like, even now, as even today, if you ask me, the biggest challenge is bringing law in or digital space under the forum of umbrella of the legal system is the biggest difficulty or the biggest challenge that we are going through now. Mm-hmm. That is going to get worse or, you know, more difficult, is what I feel.
Oh, sorry. I just thought of another one. Tell me something. Have you seen an uptick in terms of the kinds of financial crimes that people are seeing based on the fact that a device in their hand is now their wallet? You know, so are you seeing, and I'm not so sure how much people are aware of their security protocols that they're supposed to be following, but you have UPI, you have your cards, you have everything saved in your phone. Have you seen those kind of issues increasing because of the ease of digital payments in India?
Absolutely. During the pandemic, I think it has gone, at least my office has seen a 200% rise in the number of issues being reported by individuals because of this digital payment system, which it is, see, more than people learning about the system and getting to know what the basics are and then using it, it is more of a style statement now that, you know, okay, do you have a Google Pay? Yes, I have a Google Pay. Do you have a UPI? I have a UPI. Do you have some, HDFC wallet? Yes, I have an HDFC wallet. It's like, you know, okay, you have 4, I have 40. Some kind of a status symbol and some kind of a social prominence or something that people get around with this kind of a thing. So none of these people have actually learned the different aspects of online digital payment or digital wallet system and then started using it. They've not done it at all. They have not even bothered to understand the basics of it.
Okay.
They've not understood that your OTP or your PIN is equal to your signature on the check. They're very careful. They will not sign the check. They will not leave the check anywhere, nothing. But then they've not understood that, you know, it's equally unsafe to leave this PIN or passcode or OTP lying around. I mean, they're just they're so cool about it that they don't mind sharing their wallet or sharing their PIN number with random people also. They don't find there needs to be any kind of a security. We've also seen a case during the pandemic recently where the shopkeeper has that scan barcode placed in front of the shop. Yeah. Where people say, okay, you can buy and walk over. Somebody comes in, like, you know, you have a shop there, you have placed a barcode there. I walk in, I distract you, and over your barcode, I go about placing another sticker, which is my barcode.
Oh, okay.
If somebody comes, buys one, maybe one pen, 50 rupees pen, or, you know, 100 rupees shampoo or something, buys it, scans the barcode and says, I've paid, and walks off.
True.
The money 50 rupees or 100 rupees, I get it, you don't get it.
Very true. Very true. Yeah, we did hear about
what is the expenses.
Yeah.
I mean, this was rampant. The cases that we have looked into, the most number of cases that we have dealt with similar lines are from Tamil Nadu, basically. But we've done cases in Karnataka and Kerala also. Same thing. So people don't understand that, you know, there could be some kind of a problem. Even the shopkeepers, when we kept telling them that you have to understand, you just go check your barcode, they just felt it. This can't happen. This is our barcode. How will we now verify whether this barcode is ours or not? You get a printout, we've placed it there. That's all.
Yeah. But that's a very frightening situation, honestly, if you ask me. So, okay. So, a couple of things that I'm going to ask before we can actually close off the interview. Dhanya, one, tell me, if you had to give a message to today's youngsters, you mentioned that you are dealing with a lot of cybercrimes against children and women. What is the one thing that you would want to tell youngsters? That's my question number one. And second would be, what would you want to say to the general public? What is it that you would want to warn them of?
Both to the youngsters and the general public, the answer would be common. Be aware, alert, and learn the technology. Understand, learn the technology. It's as important as learning to drive before you take your vehicle on to the roads.
Wow.
That you learn what this technology is all about.
That is extremely nicely put. I like that analogy of taking your vehicle out onto the street. Before that, you have to learn to drive. Very nice. All right, Dhanya, thank you so very much. This has been an extremely interesting session. Just one last thing. Is there any case that you would want to maybe, you know, just share, or which sort of brings out the seriousness of how things are? I don't want you naming names or anything at all, but is there an incident like that you would like to share?
No, any kind of an incident that has made me think twice or affected me personally would be cases which are related to children. Because corporate cases, I always say, you know, however challenging the issue may be technically and legally, finally it all comes down and points down to money. But when it relates to children, it is always a matter of life. I wouldn't say life and death, but life alone, because no matter what happens, no matter what we do, I have not seen a life reinstated back to normalcy or back to the same state where you can say, okay, now everything is over. Sab kuch rafa dafa, start from the beginning. No.
No, it doesn't
work. It does not happen till, it doesn't work that way at all. So whenever issues related to children happen, it actually hurts me a lot. But like I said, there is no issue which is technically challenging, which has come through over the years, which is different from what has happened earlier, which is not happening now.
Okay.
But during the pandemic, I've seen a lot of children being manipulated while they're on their online games, while they are on their social media, and also while they're on their educational material online. Because a lot of these links that are sent by the teachers to the child to, you know, probably have a reference, take a reference, or study more, or things like that. All these links do have some kind of a infection, which is wherein they get access to the child's personal gadget. Either it could be the WhatsApp ID or the Gmail ID through which they get access to their Facebook or their Instagram IDs, etc. And then there's a conversation which starts off, and then the children are actually made to record or take vulnerable photographs and videos of themselves
Wow. Okay.
and send it across, where children you know, initially it's they get into it because of curiosity. Then they start getting a little small kinds of perks, like little gifts, online trades, some sort of delivery gifts that they get home. Okay. Delivered home to, and all that. Then from there, it becomes a methodology where the children can look forward for easy money.
Wow. For very honestly, this is something that scares me, because being a mom, two girls, I get really frightened, and I keep telling my kids, you know, but unfortunately, things go wrong only once. So you have to be utterly careful about whom you're dealing with, what you are putting out there, what are you clicking on. So yeah, that's like the biggest fear as far as I'm concerned.
I told myself that thank God my son has grown up now, you know, he's 20, so past that age where I need to monitor him and all that. But yes, this is scary, because people actually, we have seen children get calls from, as if the school authorities are calling somebody who's been assigned by the principal, or the class teacher calls up a child in standard 2 and 1 and all, and ask them if they are facing any problem in their online classes, whether anybody is hurting them, whether there's any physical pain that they're undergoing. And if they say yes, then they say go somewhere and show me where it is hurting you. Okay. And the child actually very innocently, you know, shows up, lifts up the dress or removes the shirt and starts taking pictures, or shows it on the video call itself, where the other person starts recording. So we've seen this kind of a dirty, pervertic, I don't know what to use. I mean, the word that I use probably will be unparliamentary. So just it's a lot of pervertism that comes out. But then the hard hit are always the children.
Okay. Okay. My God, that's a little bit of an eye opener even for me, because very honestly, I'm in the field. I'm seeing the cases, but you're seeing them firsthand. So, I mean, definitely. Thanks so much, Dhanya, for bringing your experiences on, because I think so many people will learn from it. I hope. I don't know.
I hope so.
I'm going to be a little more scared now, I think. Yeah. Thank you so much.